Yes, my name is Lucy Ssendi, and I work with the President's Office, Regional Administration and Local Government in Tanzania. I'm the Assistant Director responsible for coordination of economic and productive sectors in the country. And I'm also the Senior Climate Change Advisor for the DCF project. The mechanism of decentralized climate finance works in three ways. The first way is the CAF approach. This is the climate adaptation fund approach, whereby communities are empowered to participate in decision making, in planning, budgeting, implementation, and even on oversight. That is the first pillar. The second pillar is the local mechanism, which is adopted from UNCDF local program. And this emphasizes on the importance of local government authorities having systems that will ensure that money is drawn from different sources and then is being utilized according to the regulations and the systems which are currently working in Tanzania. So it is through the local government development grant where money can be disbursed to local government authorities, implemented, and then tracked for performance-based results. So what I can say about this mechanism is that it enables the community to take care of their needs and also the government to meet the expectation of ensuring that they've got communities which are resilient to climate change. And this is what I usually refer to as a sandwich. This is where you have the government expectation meeting with the community needs. I can say that this is not easy most of the time because governments have expectations, but maybe they are not the same as the community needs. But this particular mechanism, because it allows a bottom-up approach, community decide what is important for them as far as climate change resilience is concerned, and the government is supporting what the community have decided. So now you'll have real development, real resilience, because there is involvement of the community and support of the government. Yeah, what I can say that this is a new, relatively new phenomena for most people, the community, the local government authorities. So adoption, acceptance is a little bit slower, but there are changes which we can see on the ground. There are people who have adopted it, have understood it, and there are people who are practicing. But there are others, and particularly on the side of community, they think maybe this is just another project. Maybe it's not going to work. But what they are seeing now, they are being empowered. It is not easy to have communities participating in decision making, have a say in what they want to be implemented and how this project is going to benefit them. So the challenge is that it's a new phenomena and many people are learning it now, even ourselves. We are learning, and the lessons we have from these pilots will inform the next steps which we are going to take. But another challenge which I foresee is that we have people in the community. Once they are empowered, they become outstanding in the community. So whenever there is another, let's say, a political election, they can be seen as very good or very qualified to stand for those positions. So they leave the community adaptation committees and they aspire for political offices. So that has brought us back. So we need to recruit new office bearers. But also we have changes in the government, like people are transferred, people retire, people die. So that also we need to all the time refresh and train afresh other people. So I think that is one of the challenges again. And another challenge, maybe there is too much expectation from the community, because we do resilience or vulnerability assessment, and they know that they are vulnerable and they need many interventions, but we don't have resources to cater for all those. So it is kind of, they think they will need more, and we need more funds, I think, to be able to cater for their needs. But also we need to build the self-help initiative within themselves. There are many things communities can do without the government. So we want to build that within the same mechanism so that people will show what they can do and then the government will support what the people are doing. And this is what we are doing with the new O&O to improve the mechanism, that we work with people's initiative rather than a wish list of what they want to be done. Now we are piloting it in 3 districts, but next year we are going to start communication with further 12 districts. So we'll have a pilot of about 15 districts. The 3 districts we are working with come from the same agroecological area. The Maasai, it is dry land, they have similar livelihood enterprises, but the 12 districts are diverse. We have communities from the coast, we have communities from the central part of Tanzania, the highlands, etc. So we want to take the lessons we have learned from here and upscale to the 12 districts so that we can learn the different diversities of different traditions, cultures, climate, and when we come to upscale to the whole country, then we'll have lessons which will inform the next step which we are going to take.